That spirit of depression that's been haunting you from a small girl is going to go tonight. You know what I'm talking about.
Yes.
It's just like that, and you feel depressed.
Yes.
Yeah. And voices tell you, make an end of your life.
Yes.
You even felt like committing suicide just about 7-8 days ago. The voice was saying to you, make an end of it all. Am I lying?
No.
Am I speaking truth?
Yes.
Yeah. God's going to set you free from that suicidal spirit that's on your life. Power of God all over the girl. Tonight we curse that spirit of suicide. Set you free in Jesus' name. Free in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Be loosed from this demon spirit. There comes the life. Peace. Look at me. I set you free. Free. You can just testify the pain that you had in your upper womb is gone now. Is it true? You had a lot of pain here, and now
it's gone.
It's gone. Come on, people.
Let's join the service now as we listen to this life-changing word straight from the heart of God by Prophet Quibus.
God wants to answer our prayers. Hebrews 11 verse 6 says, he that goes to God must believe that he is, and a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. God is no man's debtor. If we pray, do we expect God to answer us? If we expect God to answer us, why is it that we don't get answers to all our prayers? If we ask for something, the Bible says, Jesus proclaimed it. He says, if you that are evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give to you that ask him? So if my children ask me something, I give. Most of the times, there's times where I say, just wait a while, or let's do it tomorrow, let's look at it another time. But eventually, most of the times they get what they ask for, because I'm their father and they my children. Now, what about our Heavenly Father? Why is it that he states we can ask him, then we ask him and we don't get, but we feel happy because we've prayed? Okay? Don't look ugly. We feel happy because we've prayed. You, ek het nou gebid vir oggend, jong. You know, what are you trying? Who are you trying to impress? You've asked for an hour, you've asked. Just imagine one of those prayers must be answered within the next week. You know, we'll have a mass funeral. You know what? That's exactly what he wants to do. We want to get from God. Now, this scripture that I love to quote when it comes to prayer is 1 John chapter 3, verse 20. Maybe we'll touch on it later on. But he says, if our heart condemns us, God is greater than our hearts and knoweth all things. If our heart condemn us not, whatsoever we ask, we receive. Now that's a heavy scripture. We read it because we're Christians and we go to church and we just read, if our heart condemn us not, you know, God is greater, and whatsoever we ask, we receive. Imagine we receive whatever we ask. Now the thing that stands in the way is condemnation. Okay? So tonight, 1 Corinthians 15. Let's start somewhere. 1 Corinthians 15:56. It's now sin is the sting of death, and sin exercised its power through the law. King James Bible, the strength of sin is the law. Just keep your Bibles open. I'll just put it in another way. Sin has its power in the law. So, no law, sin has no power. That's why the Bible says in Romans 5, from Adam till Moses, death reigned. From Moses till Christ, the law reigned. from Christ, grace. Okay? So there's three things that reigned on the earth. So sin didn't have power there. So that's why people just died. So we heard on Sunday again, the wages of sin is death, not the wages of Satan. Okay? Sin kills you, not the devil. Because he that had power over death was conquered. So the devil can't kill you. Hebrews says, he that had power over death, Christ conquered him. Hebrews 2. So the wages of sin is death. So if I'm in the law, there's no power in sin without the law. So I die if I don't keep the law. But what about grace? You know? So if I'm living in grace, one scripture upon another scripture says, Christ came that we might have life and have it more abundantly. If we have the Son, we have life. And we shall never die. You know, if you believe in me, you shall live and not die. So why is it that people still die? Now he says here, the sting of death is sin, which has its power in the law. So people still die because of sin. The wages of sin is still death. But why do people die because of sin? Because of the law. But because we're not under law, we're under grace. Verse 57. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory, making us conquerors through our Lord Jesus Christ. Sin has its power in the law. But in this fashion, thanks be to God. Thanks God. He gives us victory over the sin and the law through Christ. Just keep it in mind. We're going to go a little deep tonight. Okay, Romans chapter 8, 31. We all know it. What shall we say to these things? If God is for us, if God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Okay, just look this way. God did not spare his own son. So Christ was delivered up to die on the cross. So if God didn't spare his son, but gave him up to die, so Jesus died for us. So if God was prepared to have his son nailed to that tree, how much more, will he freely give us So if our heart condemns us not, whatever we ask, we receive. Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifieth. Who is there to condemn us? Okay. Now you must listen. Who is there to condemn us? Will Christ Jesus, who died, or rather who was raised from the dead, who is at the right hand of God, actually pleading as he intercedes for us? Who shall ever separate us from Christ's love? Shall suffering, affliction, tribulation, calamity, distress, persecution, hunger, destitution, peril, sword, even as it is written, for thy sake we are put to death all the day long. We are regarded and counted as sheep for the slaughter. Yet, amid all these things, we are more than conquerors and gain a surpassing victory through him who loved us. Who can condemn you? If Christ and God, let's just put it in words that we can brought you righteousness and justification. Jesus dying on the cross, you are now righteous. God made him who knew no sin to become sin for us, that we can become the righteous of Christ, God in Christ Jesus. You are justified. Who can then lay any charge? Who can lay a charge? Who can lay any charge? Who can condemn you? When it comes to accusations, in the Old Testament, we had an accuser of the brethren in Job and in Zechariah. And he's quoted about him in Revelation 12, called Satan. And that's actually what his name means. He's the accuser. Satan is the accuser of the brethren. Did you know that he was cast out of heaven long before man was on this earth? That's the normal belief. But he was deprived of entrance into heaven when Christ was crucified. So he was cast out of heaven before man was created. But final entrance was prohibited from him after Christ was crucified. I'm trying to say this. So he didn't stay in heaven in the Old Testament. He didn't stand there and accuse the people of God. See, that's the belief that people have. He stood there and accused the brethren day and night, all day long, because quoting a scripture out of context. The Bible says in Job 1, verse 6 and 7, "And on a day when the sons of God presented themselves before God, and they were speaking to God," it says in brackets, angels in the Amplified Bible, he said, "Satan also came in amongst them." He didn't come with them. He wasn't counted with them. He wasn't one of them. He sneaked in amongst them, and God said to him, "Where do you come from?" He says, "Oh, from my roamings on the earth." That's where he was positioned, on earth. God said to Adam and Eve, "Subdue the earth. Have dominion on the earth." So Satan was on this earth. And the Bible says he was more guile than all the other animals, and he came. He wasn't in heaven. He was on earth. And he sneaked into the heavens, and God said, "Where do you come from? You're not supposed to be here." He says, God said, "But seeing that you're here, have you seen my servant Job?" Okay, so I just want to say, he is the accuser that sneaked into heaven from where he was thrown out. But in Revelation chapter 12, the Bible says he's cast out. When was he cast out? Okay, he was cast out. When was he cast out? At the crucifixion, again. Where do we read that? John 12, 31. He says, "Jesus, now is the judgment of the world. Now the ruler of this world, the ruler, will be cast out." So there's no more any entrance for Satan in heaven. So who can lay a charge against you? Who can condemn you? So what can prevent me from receiving freely all things? What is the things that can bring a charge against me and can condemn me? Only my heart. Nothing except my heart. Why don't we have total victory? Why are we not? We go, "Oh, I'm more than a conqueror." No, more than a conqueror is the one that's got all things. I mean, he's conquered and defeated poverty, distress, sickness, and anxiety, and fear, and all those things. So why don't we get all these things? Because we are condemned. Why are we condemned? Because of our hearts. So what brings in condemnation in your life? That's the only thing that can tell you you've done wrong. So, and the law gives power to sin. But if there's no law, sin has no power. You can go read Romans 3, right through Romans 6. Without the law, sin has no power. Okay? So now, if I say I'm living by grace, grace says you are free, not because you deserve it, but because I died for you. Colossians 2, verse 13. "And you who were dead in trespasses and in uncircumcision of your flesh, your sensuality, your sinful carnal nature, God brought to life together with Christ, having freely," thank you, "forgiven us all our transgressions." How did he forgive you? Freely. So if he freely forgave you, he freely want to give to you. Did you deserve to get saved? So what made you accept Christ? The fact that you knew you were unworthy? The fact that you knew you were a sinner? You don't accept Christ because you're holy and you feel righteous and you feel you're on top of the world. You accept Christ because you feel you don't make it. So how are you saved? Freely. So if he's freely forgiven you, the same gift says he freely will give to you. So why can we accept freely salvation, but we can't freely accept anything that's lower than salvation? So we are saved by grace, but we are righteous by works. Having cancelled, blotted out, wiped away the handwriting of the note with its legal decrees and demands, which was in force and stood against us. This note with its regulations, decrees, and demands, he set aside and cleared completely out of the way by nailing it to his cross. First thing, when Christ died, the law was taken out of the way. It was cleared. It was canceled. The handwriting that stood against you, which handwriting? Of God. I am the Lord your God. Thou shalt not have any other gods before me. You shall not, you shall not, I am, and you shall not. That handwriting, he canceled it, blotted it out, wiped it out, take it out of the way by nailing it to the cross. So who can now lay a charge against you? So you've got to go over the dead body of Christ if you want to get a charge. Who can now condemn you if Christ died for you and you are now righteous? How can you still feel condemned? Satan can't condemn you. Why not? Next point, 15. God disarmed the principalities and the powers that were ranged against us and made a bold display and public example of them in triumphing over them in him and in the cross. Therefore, let no one sit in judgment on you in matters of food, drink, or with regard to a feast day, a new moon, or a Sabbath. Are people sitting in judgment on you on the things that you do and say? Or are we free? Okay. Now remember, this is what Paul said. Shall I go on sinning now that I'm free by grace? He said, no. If I understand this, I will not sin. But it's because I try not to sin that I sin. Because I try not to sin because I feel condemned. It's not a matter of how I try not to. It's a matter of how I believe. So it's not what I do to get. It's what I believe to get. All things are possible for those that believe. Not for those who do. For those who believe. Can we go back to verse 9 and 10? For in him, the whole fullness of deity, the Godhead, continues to dwell in bodily form. Verse 10, and you are in him, made full, and having come to fullness of life in Christ, you too are filled with the Godhead. And he is the head of all rule and authority. He is the head of how many rulers? All rule and all. Now, I want you to notice when it comes to rulers, principalities, powers, we have got all the spiritual warfare books that call Satan and his demons. Have you ever noticed that the name is not put in those categories? He's talking about ranks, authorities of different ranks that was in the heavenlies and was placed in the heavenlies. Christ put the authorities there. He put the ranks of authorities there. But he is above all rank and authority. And then he conquered all ranks and authority, made an open display of all ranks and authority, stripped them of power, all rank and authority. And now we got Christ in us who is over all rank and authority. Ephesians 1:18. Paul prays that our hearts be flooded with light, that we can know the inheritance of Christ that's in the saints. We've got an inheritance. So that we can know what is the immeasurable, unlimited, and surpassing greatness of his power in and for us who believe, as demonstrated in the working of his mighty strength, which he exerted in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his own right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule, all authority, all power, all dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the and in this world, but also in the age and the world that is to come. And he has put all things under his feet and has appointed him the universal and supreme head of the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. I want to humbly ask a question tonight. Where does Satan come in? We say, Satan tempted me. Is that so? The Bible says every man is tempted by his own lusts. James chapter 1. Satan did tempt. He does not tempt anymore. Your own lust now tempts you. Okay? We're going to start dealing tonight with the question of Satan and the question of sin. And it's two traditions. Remember, the word is of no effect because of our traditions. We've got a tradition about sin and a tradition about Satan that keeps us away from receiving all things. All right? What did Christ deal with on the cross? No, with the law. Deuteronomy 28 says, verses 1 through 14, if you do the commandments, you'll be blessed. It's conditional blessings, it's not blessings. If you don't, you'll be cursed. Are you right? Now, for years we've learned Christ has redeemed us from the curse. Galatians 3:13. Christ redeems from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone that hangs on a tree, that the blessings of Abraham had come on the Gentiles. Then we learned, but these blessings were not Abraham's blessings, they were Moses's. That's right. That's right. This wasn't, Deuteronomy 28 is not given to Abraham. This is 400 years after Abraham. That's given to Moses. Okay? So, John 1, I did it on Saturday night. Moses gave them the law. Christ gave them grace. Okay? So the Bible says, John 1, verse 15, 16, 17, the law was given by Moses. Grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. And out of his fullness of grace have we all received grace for grace. So Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law. Not from the curse of Moses. From the curse of the law. So the law was nailed to the cross. Are you ready? So the ifs were dealt with on the cross. We all say yes. We all believe this. So if something goes wrong, what do you ask? What have I done wrong? If you did something wrong, you know better than anybody else. No man can lay charge against you. No one can condemn you. Christ is in you. You are in Christ. The only person that can condemn you is your heart that still clings to the law that says sin has power over you. But sin has lost its power, 1 Corinthians 15, when Christ died on the cross. Sin has lost its power because the law was taken away. So the only thing sin does now, it hinders me from being bold in the presence of God. So the only way I get rid of sin consciousness is say sorry. But sin is not the thing that stands in my way. You're in the law, man. So nobody can be righteous by the law. No man can receive by keeping the law. For if you trespass one of them, you've trespassed them all. So you stand guilty, your heart condemns you, you don't get. It'll fall in a few hearts. Let's go to Romans 3. Verse 20. For no person will be justified, made righteous, acquitted, and judged acceptable in his sight by observing the works prescribed by the law. For the real function of the law is to make men recognize and be conscious of sin. Not mere perception, but an acquaintance with sin, which worked toward repentance, faith, and holy character. But now, you see, if we just read that, it seems like we must still do it. But now, the righteousness of God has been revealed independently, altogether apart from the law. Although actually it is attested by the law and the prophets, that's why Jesus came to fulfill them, namely the righteousness of God, which comes by believing. Thank you. With personal trust and confident reliance on Jesus Christ. For all who believe, and there is no distinction. All are justified and made upright and in right standing with God, freely and gratuitously by His grace. Verse 25, whom God put forward as a mercy seat and propitiation by His blood, to be received through faith. I want to challenge you just on one point tonight. And that's the ifs. Yeah. The whole thing comes about, if I do wrong, if something goes wrong, I want to find out, what did I do wrong? Who said you must find out what you do wrong? Okay? The accusation letter is taken out of the way. Now, because I'm saved by grace, the Holy Spirit is there to always say, don't do that. So if I repent, I will not go back to the law to condemn me again.